Maybe you've never seen a ghost, but that doesn't mean you haven't felt the effects of ghosts. Ghosts pervade our culture, our history, and the stories in our families. Even if we don't believe in ghosts, we still can't escape them. One place where this is very true is Ireland. Today, we talk to Bob Curran, an author and historian who shares some of Ireland's famous and not-so-famous ghost stories, as well as his personal experiences with them. Today, on Homespun Haints. Hello, Hainted Loves. Welcome to Homespun Haints. I'm Becky.
Hey, I'm Diana.
And today on the show, we are continuing our deep dive into Irish folklore. We are speaking with the amazing Bob Curran himself. He is an author, a former lecturer. He's actually Dr. Robert Curran, if you want to be formal. And he has written over 41 books in multiple languages. You can find these books in like yes. Japanese and Russian. Yes. So many books about Ireland, Irish folklore, Irish witches, Irish ghost stories, Irish fairies, even
Irish vampires.
Vampires and werewolves and everything under the sun, or should I say, under the moon.
Oh, you should. For sure you should.
We're so delighted to bring him on here in a few minutes. You're going to absolutely love this. And of course, he has some great personal ghost stories of his own, which, like our previous guest, will chill you to the bone. So, Diana.
Yes.
Are you ready? Are you excited for Halloween?
I am so excited for Halloween. I'm excited that I get to come see you in Atlanta next week and come play with you at the Fernbank Museum. Ooh. It's going to be so fun.
It is going to be fun.
Hated Loves, if you're in Atlanta, make sure you get tickets to Fernbank After Dark if you can. You can still buy tickets for Fernbank After Dark. It's October 13th, Friday the 13th. Mm-hmm. An ominous, inauspicious day to do a live performance in the dark behind the Natural History Museum. But there will be fiddling. There will be singing. You don't get to hear me sing very often, but you will. There will be surprises. There will be stories. There will be props. There will be props? Madness.
Oh, madness.
I'm certain by the end of the night, after three live performances, we'll all be mad. You should come, Atlanta listeners, please. And I had a small paranormal experience while we were recording this episode with Bob.
Oh, my goodness.
You remember I told you that while we were recording, I'm sorry for this, but you have to edit out all of the sound because my toilet was running in my half bath right next to my recording studio. So this toilet is pretty old, and when you flush, it doesn't always stop running for some reason, but it doesn't really have a reason why. We've taken it apart. We'd have plumbers look at it. It just runs sometimes and gets stuck. So we're like, okay.
What is it running from?
Oh, ooh, better catch up with it. I think it's running from the portal in the bathroom.
Right? But, I mean, you do have this kind of interesting energy source.
It's... I do have a haunted mirror right across from a toilet that's constantly running water. So yeah, lots of conduits for ghosts to travel through. I'm hoping that they come in through the water and then just leave through the portal, just like a loop. I'll occasionally look over there and see a ghost just whoop across the room from the potty to the portal.
Yeah, it gives a new meaning to a portal potty.
Oh, portal pie.
All right. So anyway.
Anyway, this happens all the darn time. It happens like once a month. So it's not a huge, huge deal, but it's a constant problem with this particular potty. When we recorded this interview, I went over there after recording. I'm like, okay, what's going on? It looked like the little chain had fallen off of the little flapper thing. And I'm like, oh, that's an easy fix. So I pick up the chain and then I notice that the toilet's running because something is caught underneath the little flappy thing. Sorry for
technical
my terminology,
terms.
Plumbers. I probably do know what the thing is called, but it's eluding me right now.
The little plastic round thing that's at the bottom of the chain, right? That's what you're talking
yes,
about?
Yes, that lifts up to flush the toilet.
We've all lived in student housing, we know that you have to jiggle with this when the toilet starts.
You gotta jiggle it sometimes. Yeah. It's not a perfect system.
So you lift this up.
I lifted up the flap, and lo and behold, there's an object keeping it open. A small object, which, of course, every single time I've done this in the past, was not there. I pull the object out of the toilet with my bare hands, because I'm a raccoon like that. I go over to the sink and I rinse it off. This is the tank of the toilet, so it's clean water, but you know.
That's what they always tell us, but
that's what they tell you.
I wouldn't drink it.
How well does gravity work with bacteria, really? Yeah. How well does a little plastic cap work with, I don't know.
Yeah, it's absorbent.
Anyway, so in theory, it's clean water. I rinsed off, though. I washed off the little ceramic item that I had pulled out of the potty, and it was a tiny ceramic pink rose. And the weird thing is, I know exactly where this tiny ceramic pink rose came from. My grandmother, when I was approximately 10 years old or something, her hobby was to make ceramics and paint them. She would put them in a mold, put them in the kiln, fire them, and then she would hand paint them by herself and then fire glaze them. This was her hobby. She loved making ceramics. When I was about 10, she made me a beautiful ceramic unicorn about like 8 inches long with its legs folded up underneath it, just like it was sleeping in a pasture. And it had all these little pink and purple flowers in its hair. And this is one of the little flowers that was attached to my beautiful unicorn from when I was 10.
Where's the rest of the unicorn?
Nobody knows. Why wasn't this tiny little flower in the toilet tank the last 15 times I went to go take it apart, put it back together again? Where did it come from? How is this possible? Why is it off of the unicorn? Where's the unicorn? What's going on here? I don't remember breaking off any of those back when I owned that unicorn. I don't remember breaking it at all. I wouldn't touch it. It was ceramic. It wasn't like a toy that you played with as a child. It was something you sat on a shelf and looked at, you know, a curio cabinet kind of thing.
I have an idea.
You have a theory. It came through the portal during one of my time travel incidents.
It did. But it's from the future. 40 years from now, you're going to find that unicorn in a pile of books that you thought you had discarded, somehow has traveled with you across the world. Because you know things like that happen?
Yeah.
You'll find something. Oh, yeah. I found a ticket to see Mr. Bungle at the House of Blues in Chicago in 1998.
Wow, that's a while ago.
I have moved 10 times since, and I found this ticket, paper ticket, back when you had paper tickets, to see Mr. Bungle. It was Hawaiian night. Everybody was supposed to wear these grass skirts and coconuts, and only the band dressed up because it was Mr. Bungle. If you're not familiar with Mr. Bungle, go look it up. Guy from Faith No More. He started this band, and his goal was to include absolutely every single musical genre in every single piece. It's a hoot. But anyway.
I understand now why it's called Mr. Bungle.
Okay, sorry. Weird analogy, but it's like that. It's like that. I'll find something like that. I've moved cross country twice. I've been in, I don't even know how many relationships, discarded everything I owned and started over multiple times during this time period, so many times, and then this ticket shows up in my closet. So I think it's like that. I think it's definitely a portal thing.
Okay.
But it's from the future. I do think it's going to be 40 years from the future. You're going to find this unicorn. You're going to be like, what the hell? And then you're going to remember this. And then you're going to break off a little rose. And you're going to dump it in the potty just so you can complete the circuit.
What happens if I don't?
Don't. We don't want to know. Then the universe will cease to exist as we know it. Diana, it is your job.
I don't know, that sounds nice. You sure you like the universe as we know it?
That's you true. Sure? I mean, better the enemy that you know than the enemy you don't? I don't know.
You heard it here first, Tainted Loves. Homespun Haints, enemies of the universe. That's who we are.
Okay, so all joking aside, that is really weird.
It's super weird. Can you think of a scientific explanation for this? Because I'm racking my brains, but there is nothing I can figure out. There's not like a shelf above it that would have had anything fall into it. There was indeed a shelf above it a long time ago.
Did this potty stop running after you pulled out the rose?
Well, yeah, because I fixed the little flappy flap. I fixed it.
Is it possible that it's been running this whole time because the rose has been down there for the last 30 years?
That would be really strange that it just decided to somehow emerge.
I mean, I don't know how toilets work.
I know how gravity and water work. It's not like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's supposed to go down, not up. I got nothing. I mean, especially if you've had plumbers take this apart.
plumbers have looked at this and tried to fix it for me and just been like, well, you might need a new toilet, might have problems. And I'm like, well, it works 99% of the time.
Did they look in the U-bin to see if this has been stuck there for decades?
Yeah. I had a plumber go through the thing because when it would rain really hard, it was having a little trouble with flushing on the first go. And so I did have a plumber take it apart, look in the U-bin, make sure it wasn't.
Okay, again, just like you,
I don't know how toilets work. So I don't know if he just sat in there for 20 minutes on his phone and then came out and told me it was okay. And I needed a new toilet if I wanted to fix the problems. I have no idea what he did in there.
No, but I mean, you can stick a camera in there. So I imagine that's probably what he did. You know, a little camera on the scoopy things.
Give it around. A little colonoscopy.
Yeah, I'm sure they would have seen a ceramic rose. Would be like, oh, that's your problem. I don't know, Diana. It is one of those mysteries. I think that you clearly have a very haunted bathroom, and that's been established. What I think you should do is you should set up an infrared camera outside of the bathroom and just record it at night and see if you see the ghost jumping from the toilet to the mirror or from the mirror to the toilet.
Uh-oh.
Because it's going to be one or the other. Absolutely.
It's going to be one or the other, but the second would be bad. I don't want a haunted toilet. I have to sit there.
Well, that's why you have a rose in it.
For protection or as a gift from a ghost?
It's obviously from another time period. Was the rose in good shape?
In perfect shape, except for the fact that it's been broken off of what it used to be attached to.
But like no nicks or anything. The glaze hasn't been worn off.
I have it right here. Touching toilet roses right now. No, there's still a bit of glue attached to the back of it from where it used to be attached to the unicorn.
Oh my gosh, that's incredibly detailed.
Isn't my grandma amazing?
Something like that would wear down over time if it were repeatedly being flushed over and over again, having water washed over it. That I do know. My archaeology degree does come in useful sometimes.
Let's see how. Yep. I gave it like the slightest little like flick and the glue came right off.
Okay. Haunted toilet.
So there's no way it's been swirling around in the U-bend for years.
Yeah.
That's not possible.
No, not at all. Even a bone would have deteriorated. All right. Haunted loves. Do you have an idea for why Diana has a haunted rose in her haunted toilet? Or if it's the toilet that's haunted or the mirror that spat the rose into the toilet? Is somebody messing with her? Is somebody upset that we opened the secret passageway? Was the rose supposed to be in the secret passageway in Diana's basement and it eluded us by hiding out in her toilet? All these theories abound. We don't know. But what we do know is that we are so thankful to all of our patrons who have been a part of our Patreon this whole time. Did you like that transition? That was smooth, right? Man, I should go work for NPR.
Oh, like peanut butter.
Both of us are allergic to peanut butter, so maybe not a good analogy.
That's true. Maybe not.
We just want to give a big shout out to all of our patrons. Thank you so much for everything you do and for making all of this possible. If you too would like to support us, please visit our Patreon at patreon.com/homespunhaints.
Or just hear all of our secrets, because that's who gets to hear them, right, patrons? All our secrets. But if you're not our patron, guess what else you get to hear? A commercial now.
Today on the show, we are delighted to talk to Bob Curran, or Dr. Bob, as he is sometimes referred to. He is an author, a folklorist, a historian. I picked up a copy of Bob's book, A Bewitched Land, Witches and Warlocks of Ireland, and I absolutely fell in love with all of the stories in there. It's all about some of the witch folklore that we've talked about previously on this show. I believe there's a whole chapter devoted to Biddy Early, who we have spoken about. And then I come to learn that Bob also has written books about ghosts and other types of more spooky folklore out of Ireland. So I am very excited to have him come on today. Bob, thank you so much for chatting with us today.
It's a pleasure to be with you both. Thank you very much for inviting me on.
Bob, you have written so many things, and that you've also been working on comic books now as well.
Yes.
What would you say is your primary focus?
I lectured for a while and lectured at university. And one of the primary things which I wondered about was not whether or not ghosts or witches exist, but why people would want to believe in them. As far as ghosts are concerned, and we can tell you a few ghost stories, but as far as ghosts are concerned, they provide a link with the past, whether it be personal, whether it be historical. or whether it be cultural. Now, for example, before we began and when we were talking earlier, you asked me, had I ever seen a ghost? No, but I've smelt one.
Oh.
And you may have done the same. I went into a room in which an old aunt of mine had died, and she always wore a certain sort of perfume. And you step into the room and you can smell the perfume. Now, that is your brain making a connection between that. So that's a kind of personal ghost, if you like. Then you're at a place which is very awe-inspiring. Now, for example, I went down to the most haunted castle in Western Europe, or so they say, which is in Ireland. It is Lepp Castle in County Offaly. You may have heard about it. And my wife was so terrified she wouldn't go into it. I went there to speak to a group of Americans. People were a bit apprehensive about going in. There were stories that they'd seen children playing on the lawn in Victorian clothing and stuff like that. So you're making a link with the past, and people make the link. Then you have the cultural link, because I suppose everybody wants to know what happens to you whenever you die. This is the end of all things. You're basically into religion and stuff like that. So you want to find out if there is anything beyond. I think there's an innate distaste for us to think that there's nothing out there, that this is all there is. So maybe a ghost or some other power outside provides us with a kind of reassurance about ourselves and gives us an identity about ourselves. So you have a cultural, you have a historical, you have a personal connection, and that brings in ghosts and witches and precognition and whatever you want.
Before we began recording, you mentioned that there are several different kinds of ghosts. Can you educate us on what those kinds of ghosts are?
Ghosts in Ireland tend to come in various forms. You can have the ghost of a dead person. Even there, it's very complicated, because it was believed in certain areas that on certain nights of the year, if you were incredibly good or had been very holy, you were allowed to come back on one night of the year for a certain period. Maybe 2 or 3 years, you were allowed to come back one night of the year and enjoy the things you had enjoyed whilst you were alive. For example, myself and Mary, my wife, went down to County Fermanagh and spoke to an old gentleman called George Sheridan, who told us a story about his grandfather coming back on the night of the year and him as a small boy climbing on the corpse's knee and finding the skin very cold.
Ooh.
His grandfather, strangely, he says, didn't speak, but he was allowed to take a glass of whiskey and was allowed to sit at the fire. And a chair was kept for him. Where I was brought up, country people always sat on certain nights of the year an extra seat at the table in case somebody going past, a corpse going past, would come in and you weren't allowed to refuse them and sit down. Strangely enough, is also a custom in Croatia. I heard a story from southern Bulgaria, actually, where a guy was brought into a house and with a family and was sitting in, and a strange man came in and sat down at the table and ate with them and didn't speak to them. As each of the men rose from the table, they touched him on the shoulder and walked out. And that was for good luck. You touch a corpse's shoulder for good luck.
The night of the year that these people could come back, was that always on Halloween or was it a different night?
It could be. For instance, on Christmas Eve, there was an old lady who lived not too far from us. And she sat out the chairs round the fireplace before she went to bed so that her dead relatives could come back on Christmas Eve night and sit round the fire and enjoy themselves. And she put what we called, if you'll pardon an Irish word, the gleesons. Now that's the fine ash at the foot of the grate. Scattered it on the hearthstone. And if it was disturbed in the morning, she knew they'd been there and that they had danced on the hearthstone.
Oh,
nice. So that is one type of ghost. Then you have the pattern. Now a pattern is the ghost of a living person. For example, people have seen, people may be going through the country and have seen people whom they couldn't possibly have seen because those people are somewhere else. Once again, in one of the books that I've written, I tell a story from the Clutter Valley of a family. In fact, I was taken to the farmhouse and showed where the family had lived. One of the family was a wayward son who went to Canada. And the farm was managed by a sister and a brother. Now, one night, the sister came out to milk the cattle. There was the brother who was in Canada, standing in the byre. And she spoke to him, but he didn't speak and turned away. And then a letter came from Canada that he had been killed in a mining camp. Again, you see people, and it is not a good omen to see a pattern. It can also be the likeness of a murdered person who has been murdered somewhere. The last sort of ghost I'll leave you with was down where my grandmother lived. There was what was called a caldrich. Now, a caldrich is an Irish word. It is an area which is set aside in a field for the burial of unbaptized children and suicides, those who cannot be given proper rest by the church. And we were not allowed to cross that after 6 p.m. because the spirits were seeking their way back into the world and might take you over.
Oh, like possess you in a way. The unbaptized or the suicides. You said that was in a field. Would it have been at a crossroads? Because that's a tradition here.
Not necessarily. It was a piece of land which would be given over by maybe a farmer. He would allow. Now, that was always cordoned off. It was either by a low stone wall or a turf bank to keep people out. Now, can I come back to the pattern? And I'll tell you about a very serious Irish witchcraft, which appeared in the Appalachians as well, which was known as the Dumb Supper.
We love this.
Only a woman could perform this. In fact, I remember a woman, or a young girl, who was excommunicated from the local church for performing the Dumb Supper. And I, supposing you wanted to know who you were going to marry, or supposing you had fixated on a young man who maybe wasn't returning your attention, who was not wanting your attention, what you did was you cleared the house at night so that the house was completely silent. You had to brush out the house. The house had to be completely clean and completely silent. Even the clocks had to be stopped so that it wouldn't tick. Then you made a cake. There were various recipes for making cake, but it had to be flour and salt. I should also point out that this is also very dangerous, and I'll tell you why in a moment. But you made the cake. The cake had to be baked in complete silence. You took an iron knife and laid it across the cake. This all had to be completed by 12 o'clock at night. And then you waited. And then at the stroke at 12 o'clock, the door would open and the image of the man you wanted would come in. And he would walk across and lift the iron knife and cut the cake. And at that minute, you had him. But if you made a sound while he was there, you killed him.
Oh.
And that was why it was considered very much a thing of dark witchcraft.
So if you die at a dumb supper, you die in real life. That is dangerous. Maybe not for the person holding it.
But your soul was completely damned.
Yeah.
You would never see heaven.
I'm curious if the reason that it's so damning is because it's controlling somebody else. You're literally forcing them to return your affections at the dumb supper.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a sort of twisted love magic, if you want, because this person is not paying you attention and you want that. This is something which you're taking from the person. And the Catholic Church, anyway, said that it was black witchcraft. It was outside the realms of, you had mentioned Biddy earlier, these were wise women who worked with herbs. These were tolerated by the priests. Quite often were tolerated. Biddy early wasn't quite tolerated by the church, although she did accept the church on her deathbed. But some of these women, there were women in my part of the world in which my granny would say, oh, you don't go near those women. For they're bad.
In addition to plenty of ghosts, I understand that Ireland has one of the oldest vampire legends in the world.
All right. If you ever come across to Ireland, either of the two of you, come and see me, and I will take you to the grave of a vampire, which is still extant. Ireland had one of the very first vampire stories in Carmilla, Sheridan Le Fanu, and through Dracula. Now, Dracula was written by Bram Stoker, who was an Irishman, and he may have used the story of Auchtach. I am sitting talking to you 11 miles from the vampire's grave. The story is that about the 5th century, the area 11 miles from here, which is known as Glen Owen, was a series of small kingdoms. Now, whenever the Irish talk about kingdoms, they're not talking about massive places. They're talking about a place run by a local warlord in these times. Auchtacht was a local warlord in the kingdom. The place is a valley. And he was supposed to be deformed, but he was also supposed to be a great tyrant. And in order to try and extend his life, he demanded a bowl of blood from the wrists. Now, no vampire, you may know, drinks from the neck, because you'd be cutting the jugular vein, and that would be very, very messy. Even the vampire bat drinks from your foot, from the sole of your foot. He demanded a basin of blood, but he died anyway, and he was buried. He was buried standing up, as befitted an Irish chieftain. Within a day, he was back. And he demanded the same bowl of blood. And the people went across the mountain and met with another chieftain called Cachan and asked him to come and get rid of Auchtacht, which he did. He slew him and put him back in his grave. Next day he was back and demanded the same bowl of blood. So Cachan said, he says, I don't know why I'm supposed to have killed him. So he went to either, if you like, a druid or an early Christian holy man and said, look, what is happening here? And the man said, he is not dead. His sorcery has kept him alive. But he is one of what we called the Maravio, or the night walking dead. And he can't be slain. He can be suspended. And in order to suspend him, you need to strike him with a sword made of yew wood, bury him upside down and in a place where thorns are scattered about. Now that is actually also a Slavic notion, where if you bury a vampire, you have to scatter either thorns or poppy seeds, because the vampire, being a very fastidious creature, will get up and collect them all. And by the time it is collected, the sun is up and it has to go back. So Cachan did this and put a massive stone on the top of it.
So you were telling us you took a photographer to the vampire's grave.
Took a photographer to the vampire's grave. He had just returned from, I think it was Syria, where he had been. So he said, look, I have a brand new camera. He says, I want to take you on this. So I said, okay. The thing wouldn't work. We tried it from all sorts of different angles. The thing still wouldn't work. So he said, I'm going to try another camera. He tried that. It wouldn't work. So we walked up to the edge of the field, because this was in the middle of a field. And he said, now, if this works, he says, I'm going to believe that there's somebody there. And the thing worked the first time. However, I didn't come out in it. So they took the photograph and put in Bela Lugosi. So everybody thinks I look like Bela Lugosi. And I can speak like the children of the night, but the music they make. I was living in a big tall house at that time, and up the stairs in the attic I had a library, and I was alone in it, and I was up checking a book, and I went to the head of the stairs to call down to my wife, and just at that somebody put their hand on my back and oh. threw me down the stairs.
What?
I went through and hit a stone wall. Mary came up the stairs and says, are you all right? And I says, oh, I'm okay. You know, I'm stunned, but I'm okay. She says, I hope you realize one shoulder is lower than the other. The entire arm had come out.
Oh, my goodness.
This one here. So I went to Coleraine Hospital and they levered the arm back in. But that was a bit frightening.
And this is right after you had visited the vampires, too.
That was right after I had done that.
In your speculation, what do you think was pushing you?
Don't know. I can turn around here, Diana, and say, you know, I missed my footing or something like that. But I definitely felt something like a push. And people said to be very, very careful. Go ahead and ask me another question.
I wanted to ask about she-hogs.
Yes, she-hogs. She-hogs are neither ghosts nor fairies. They are things which appear, which we say, between the lights. That is when the sun is going down, but it's before it's moonlight. The countryside, and we're coming back to the land again. The land takes on a completely different aspect. And things which you think you know take on different shapes. And these, there can be creatures such as the Fyrgorta. Fyrgorta and the man of hunger steps back to the time of the famine. The man of hunger will come to your back door at night, and he will rattle a small tin can in which he has a bean. And that is all he has to eat. He's an emaciated character who travels the roads. And this was a skeletal creature. And if you didn't obey him and leave him out something, you suffered hardship or something in your life. She-hogs could also be things like grugochs. Grugochs were small hairy creatures. Now, they were incredibly beneficial. For instance, some of them appeared during daylight, and they could be used by farmers because they were fearfully strong workers. They were very small, they were about the height of a 2-year-old child. They were completely covered in hair, they were naked, but they were terrific workers. Farmers used to get them whenever they wanted to gather potatoes or something because they would work for nothing. All they would want for was a jug of milk. And they would work for days upon days upon days, and all you had to give them was a jug of milk. And if you give them a present, they would vanish. They were also supposed to be rather stupid. For instance, on a mountain not far from here, a farmer was going into a town called Ballycastle, and he had some sheep, which he quartered in a pen up on the side of the mountain. And he went up to the Grugoch skin because the Grugoch was incredibly untidy. He lived in a cave and he was incredibly untidy. I said he was covered in fur or hair, but mixed into those were leaves and bits of detritus and stuff like that. So he said, look, will you look after my sheep while I go in? He says, I'll only be away for half a day. And the Grugoch says, yes, I will. And unfortunately, the farmer or the shepherd went into Ballycastle and he met with a few friends and he finished up in a pub and they got very, very drunk and he stayed the entire night. So he came back and he expected the sheep to be wandering about all over the mountain. There they were, tidied up in the pen. So he says to the Grugoch, he says, you've done very, very well. He says, did they give you much trouble? And he says, no, he says, but a tiny brown one. He says, I had to chase it all over the mountain at night and put it in the pen. And he says, I don't have a tiny brown one. So he went and he looked and there was a hare lying in the middle. And the Grugoch didn't know the difference between a sheep and a hare.
So banshees are also a form of she-hog.
Banshees, yes. Banshees are also the wailing woman. Now, the banshee means a woman of the fairy, was not always a woman who cried for the dead. Because some of the ancient kings of Ireland, banshee, who were wise women, they acted as advisors. Because in Celtic society, women often were quite equal to men. But they became sort of tied up once again with the notion of divination. Because one of the things which a lot of us want to know is what's going to happen to us. If we do something, what will the outcome be? And I suppose the greatest question is, what will be the time of my death? So she became up and she cried. But there are other things about death as well. For example, there is something in Irish folklore called the Coach a Bower.
The death coach?
That's the death coach or the coach of the dead. That travels the roads. You will find that in both Irish and in Breton, in France folklore, with the Ankou. that will travel about, and at certain nights of the year, it will collect the souls of the dead who have died in the past year. Whenever my grandfather died, all mirrors and reflective surfaces were covered because the soul would be trapped, and that could only be released by the three knocks on the door, which is the death coach arriving for him. And if somebody was sick or dying and you heard the three knocks, you knew that that was the time. You also had the Dullahan, which was a headless horseman.
Ooh.
Who carried his head in front of him like a lantern, because the head shone in front of him. And he carried it, and if he called your name, that was you being called to meet your fate. And he rode on a horse which spat sparks of fire.
Oh, I love it.
He would gallop past your house. The people heard him on windy nights, galloping past. But if he stopped and you heard your name being called, that was you.
Oh, creepy. You mentioned earlier that in your family, only one person is allowed to see the ghosts, and that is not you. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Okay. Where I grew up, people were supposed in a family. Maybe one person could see the ghost. Not every person. Some people could see death. For example, there was an old woman lived down the road from us, and she said, "You see that hedge down there?" She said, "I can see death whenever there's a death in the community." She says, "I can see death peering over the hedge, looking in at me." And she says, "I know somebody's dying." A couple of stories. I grew up in an area where only one person was supposed to be able to see a ghost. It's not me. My father was supposed to have seen a ghost. My father was one of a number of children. My grandfather on my father's side was a butcher. And just down below where they lived, there was a very long lane. And at the end of the lane, there was an old man and his wife. And the old man was a great drunkard and was very, very bad to his wife. But each Friday night, my grandfather, coming home from the butcher's, would bring him some sausages or a bit of meat, and he would get one of the children to run down a big long lane and leave. Now, whenever they went, my grandfather said, "Look and see, is there a light on in the house, and then you'll know he's home." So they did that. In the end, the wife died. In fact, the guy beat her up and she died as a result.
Mm.
But the sausages still kept going. And it was my father's turn. My grandfather said, "Go to the head of the lane, take a look down, see if the light's on, and then you'll know that he's home." So my father went down, and there was the light, and he walked on down. And he walked round the side of the house, and he passed the window, and there in what they called the scullery, just off the kitchen, was the wife laying the table for supper. He turned and he fled, and he looked back, and there wasn't a light in the house.
Oh!
My grandfather on my mother's side used to tell a story. He came from South Armagh, and there was an old church not too far from there. It was a church standing in the middle of the field. It was abandoned. It was just the walls and a big tower. And he said it always had a bad name about it. But he worked as a labouring man for a couple of brothers who owned the land. One of the brothers wanted to put cows in the field, but because the church was, the walls and stuff were covered in ivy, stuff, he was afraid that the cattle would get in and eat the ivy and poison themselves. So he brought my grandfather down to cut. Now, as he was going down, he passed a crowd of tinkers sitting by the side of the road, and he wished them good day, and he went on. He was working. And he worked. The place was just an old ruin. Now, one other thing you need to know was that there was a big old tomb leading off the church, which was sealed up, but it had the crest of an old family that were long extinct in the neighbourhood. It started getting towards 6 o'clock at night, and my grandfather was working away, and they said all round him were the faces of stone angels and stuff, which didn't count, because it had been an elaborate old place. He worked away, and around about 6, as the sun was going down, because this was coming into the winter time, he heard a woman crying, and he said, "It's one of the tinkers," he says, but there was nobody there. So he went out and he walked around the place, and he could still hear the woman crying, sobbing, he said, as if her heart would break. And then he realized it was coming from the tomb. And he stood and he listened, and he put his ear to the wall, and he could hear the woman on the other side of the wall sobbing. Oh. And he walked around, he looked, and the tomb was closed up. The whole thing, there was no way he could get in. And he took fright, and he went home. He came back the next day, and there wasn't a thing. But he swore that he heard the woman crying in the tomb.
Oh.
Going about the countryside, because he was a travelling labourer, he ran across these things. For example, he went to a house. It was said that there had been an incident which had happened some time ago. A brother and a sister had inherited the house, but another sibling had been cut out of the will. And it was said that the will had been drawn up, and the old woman in question hadn't wanted to sign it, but she was dying, and they lifted her hand and put the pen in her hand and drew her sign, because she put an X on the will, and they immediately inherited it. But each night, and he said he was in the house that night, because they were sleeping over, and he said something came to the window and scratched at the window, you know? And he said he was sure he woke up and there was a hand.
Scary.
So watch at your window tonight. There could be something scrabbling to get in.
When you spoke about the three types of ghosts, and you mentioned that the ghosts of the dead you call corpses, but when you're talking about corpses, do you mean corporeal, like they have a body, they've dug themselves out of the dirt, or are they, like we think of ghosts, as you can pass through them?
It's a good question, Diane, because some of them do. For example, old people in my part of the world would put out a bit of food for them going past, which would assume that they ate. This goes back, I think, to the Scandinavian, because the Scandinavian ghosts, the original ghosts actually, were all corporeal. A Scandinavian settled along parts of, for example, Strangford Loch in the north of Ireland, which is Strangfjord.
Oh.
Strong inlet. Carlingford. Carlingfjord, which is the inlet of the old woman. And their ghosts were always very corporeal. Into early medieval times, ghosts got up and strolled about and made a nuisance of themselves. There was a great ghost in the north of Scotland, Thorkell Haltfoot, who got up in the middle of the night and misbehaved himself and got half a dozen other ghosts, and they all went about and made rowdy things and got very, very drunk.
Nice.
And they couldn't get rid of Thurl. They dumped him in the sea and he came back. And in the end, they had to cut him up and burn him.
Did that work?
It did.
So they perhaps have more, a little bit in common with the Strigoi versus what we think of as ghosts.
Absolutely. The Strigoi and the Moroi, which is the blessed dead and the evil dead.
Oh, my husband's Slavic. I will have to relay this to him.
Oh, find it very interesting. That.
Yeah. This has been wonderful. And we are learning so much, too. This is such a delight for us. Thank you so much.
You're more than welcome.
Thank you, everybody who's been listening. We have been delighted to be joined today with Bob Curran. He is an author, a professor. He has over 41 titles to his name, I believe, including The World's Creepiest Places, A Bewitched Land, A Haunted Land, Field Guide to Shapeshifters, Lycanthropes, and Man-Beasts, among other things. And we will also include links to where people can purchase the books we've talked about. I know that you are published through O'Brien, you're published through Simon & Schuster, and some other publishers, and you also have comic books out as well. Thank you so much, Bob.
Thank you, Bob.
It was a pleasure, ladies.
Painted Loves, what do you think? Have you ever sat on the lap of a corpse or been summoned in a dumb supper? If so, I bet you had a spooky day.
Homespun Haints is hosted by Becky Kielimnik and Diana Doty and produced by Homespun Haints Media LLC. Editing and music by Becky Kielimnik. Show notes by Diana Doty. If you have a ghost story and you'd like to be considered as a guest for this podcast, please visit our website at homespunhaints.com/submit.